Good evening, everyone. Correct Economics and Statistics welcomes you all on this YouTube live session on Cournot and Steckelberg model of duopoly. This is Atman Shah. I teach economics at St. Xavier's College, Ahmedabad, India. You can reach us on this email ID, crack.eco.stat@gmail.com. On our YouTube channel, you can find the videos on economics, statistics, and SPSS. So I request all of you to subscribe to our YouTube channel. You can go to the playlist to find the videos or to find the categories of the themes. In previous sessions, we discussed the idea of perfect competition and short-run equilibrium in the perfect competition. How a perfectly competitive firm achieves equilibrium in the short run, what are the equilibrium conditions. And in the second session, we discussed the characteristics of monopoly, how monopolists achieve equilibrium in the short run, that is abnormal profit and loss, and the idea of deadweight loss, that is the social cost of monopoly. So if you did not attend the sessions, you can go to our YouTube channel and find the videos on these two sessions. In today's lecture, we are going to discuss the idea of duopoly, the meaning of duopoly market, Cournot model of duopoly, Steckelberg model of duopoly, and the comparison between Cournot and Steckelberg model. So let's begin with the idea of duopoly market. A duopoly is a special case of oligopoly. So in oligopoly, we have few firms. Or few producers or few sellers. But duopoly is a special case. So in duopoly, we have only two producers or two firms. So these two producers dominate the market, which means that these two producers have the power, the monopoly power to control the market supply of the commodity. If two producers collude, then they generate the same impact on the market as monopoly. Because if these two producers collude on price or output, then they work as a monopoly in the market. Normally, it is very difficult to find only two producers in the market. So if we have two firms, and if the firms have the control over the 70% share of the market, then that market is also considered as a duopoly market. So this is the idea of duopoly market. Let's take some examples. Suppose Visa and MasterCard. So these two are the dominant players in the market. Second is mobile operating systems. So we have Android and Apple. Soft drinks, we have two companies, Coca-Cola and Pepsi. Fourth is aircraft manufacturer, Airbus and Boeing. So these firms have major market share in the entire market. So there are various models of duopoly: Cournot model, Steckelberg model, Bertrand model, Chamberlain model, Edgeworth model. In this session, I'm going to discuss these two models, Cournot model and Steckelberg model, the mathematical derivation also, and the comparison between this Cournot and Steckelberg model. Cournot in 1838 developed his model in researches into the mathematical principles of the theory of wealth, in which we have two firms, firm one and firm two. So the total quantity is divided between these two firms. So total quantity Q is equal to Q1 plus Q2. Here, firms compete in quantity and not in price. So quantity is the strategic variable. That is very important when we understand the Cournot and Steckelberg model. So here firms compete in quantity and not in price. So the quantity of the firm is the strategic variable. So firm take decisions about how much to produce in the market. That is quantity. Firms decide simultaneously and independently about how much to produce. So here interdependence is not recognized because these two firms take decision simultaneously in the market and independently. So this is also known as simultaneous move game. If we talk about the game theory, then this type of game is known as simultaneous move game, in which two players take decisions simultaneously and independently. So here we have two firms. The strategic variable is quantity. So these two firms decide simultaneously and independently how much to produce of a given commodity in the market. Each firm maximizes its current profit given the output of its rival. So when firm one makes the decision, the output of firm two is given, and when firm two makes the decision, the output of firm one is given. They both are rational, so they both want to maximize their own profit. And these two firms are selling the homogeneous product. So these are the assumptions or characteristics of Cournot model. Now, what is the demand curve? So we assume that the demand curve is linear. So P is equal to A minus BQ. So here P is price, A is intercept, B is slope, and Q is total quantity in the market. So this Q is divided between two firms, that is Q1 and Q2. So total output Q is equal to Q1 plus Q2. So Q1 is the output of firm 1 and Q2 is the output of firm 2 or quantity of firm 2. So if we substitute this in the previous equation, so we have P is equal to A minus B. Now instead of Q, we write Q1 plus Q2. So now we open the bracket. So the equation is P is equal to A minus B Q1 minus B Q2. So this is our demand curve. Now what is the cost? For simplicity, we assume that marginal cost is equal to zero. You can also assume a constant C or any amount. But here for the simplicity, we assume that the marginal cost is zero. So this is our demand condition, demand curve or demand equation. And this is our cost, that is zero. So now we know that these both firms take decision simultaneously and independently. In equilibrium, marginal revenue is equal to marginal cost. We have already discussed the equilibrium condition in the first session. So a firm achieves the equilibrium when marginal revenue is equal to marginal cost. So first firm is in equilibrium when the marginal revenue is equal to marginal cost. Similarly, firm 2 is in equilibrium when MR2 is equal to MC. So these are the equilibrium conditions. Marginal cost is zero. Now we need to find the marginal revenue of the firms. That is the marginal revenue of first firm and marginal revenue of second firm. For that, we need the total revenue. So total revenue of firm 1 is TR1, is denoted as TR1. So TR1 is equal to P into Q1. Now we have the equation of P. So we substitute that equation. So TR1 is equal to A minus BQ1 minus BQ2 into Q1. because our demand equation is A minus BQ1 minus BQ2. So instead of P, we can write this equation. So therefore, TR1 is A minus BQ1 minus BQ2 into Q1. So now if we open the bracket, we have this equation A into Q1 minus B into Q1 square minus BQ1 Q2. Now, marginal revenue means the derivation of the total revenue with respect to the quantity. So marginal revenue of firm 1 is the differentiation of total revenue of firm 1 with respect to the output. So here MR1 is dTR1 upon dQ1. You can see this on your screen. So now if we differentiate the total revenue of this firm with respect to Q1, we will get this equation. So MR1, first we differentiate this with Q1, so we will get A. When we differentiate this with respect to Q1, it is 2BQ1. And now differentiate this with Q1, then we will get BQ2. So MR1 is equal to A minus 2BQ1 minus BQ2. In equilibrium, MR2 is equal to MC is equal to 0. Here, sorry, it is MR1. So MR1 is equal to MC is equal to 0. So therefore, this is our MR1. A minus 2BQ1 minus BQ2 is equal to 0. We want the value of Q1. So from this equation, we can derive this equation. 2BQ1 is equal to A minus BQ2. And therefore, Q1 is equal to A minus BQ2 upon 2B. This equation is known as reaction curve of firm 1 or reaction function of firm 1. So here we can easily say that the output of firm 1, that is Q1, depends on the output of firm 2, that is Q2. So Q1 is a function of Q2. So this is known as reaction curve or reaction function of firm 1. Now let's understand the idea of firm 2. So the total revenue of firm 2 is denoted by TR2, which is equal to P into Q2. So TR2 is A minus BQ1 minus BQ2. Instead of P, because our P is A minus BQ1 minus BQ2. So TR2 is PQ2. Instead of P, we can write A minus BQ1 minus BQ2. So our total revenue of firm 2 is AQ2 minus BQ1 Q2 minus BQ2 square. Now again, we differentiate total revenue with respect to output to get the value or to get the equation of marginal revenue of this firm. So MR2 is the differentiation of total revenue with respect to quantity. So if we differentiate this equation with respect to quantity, that is Q2. So if we differentiate this AQ2, we will get A. When we differentiate BQ1, Q2 with respect to Q2, we get BQ1. And when we differentiate BQ2 square, we'll get 2BQ2. So this is the marginal revenue curve of this firm. Now in equilibrium, we know that marginal revenue is equal to marginal cost is equal to zero. So we equate this equation with zero. So MR2 is A minus BQ1 minus 2BQ2 is equal to zero. So therefore 2BQ2 is equal to A minus BQ1. We can derive this equation from this. So therefore, Q2 is A minus B Q1 upon 2B. So this is reaction curve or reaction function of from 2. So this means that the quantity of this firm, that is firm 2, depends on the quantity of first firm. Right? Okay. Now we want the output, the result of the quantity, how much these two firms produce in the market. These two equations show the reaction of each firm with respect to the output of another firm. So how this firm 2 reacts to this Q1, or how firm 1 reacts to the output of firm 2. That is the reaction curve. So we have these two equations or these two reaction curves. Q1 is equal to A minus B Q2 upon 2B. And Q2 is equal to A minus B Q1 upon 2B. So now we substitute the value of Q2 into Q1. So therefore, Q1 is equal to A minus B. Now instead of this Q2, we can write this whole equation. So therefore, instead of Q2, we have written A minus B Q1 upon 2B. And in the whole denominator, we have 2B. So A minus, now we are opening up the bracket. So it is minus AB upon 2B. Minus into minus becomes positive. So it is plus B into B Q1, that is B square Q1 upon 2B. And in the whole denominator, we have 2B. So therefore, Q1 is equal to A. Here this BB cancel. We can cancel this 2B, that is numerator and denominator. So we have A upon 2. Again, 1B is, we can cancel out this B. So we have B Q1 upon 2. So Q1 is A2. Now A minus A2 is A2, A upon 2. If we subtract A upon 2 from A, that is half A from A, we'll get half A, that is A upon 2. Plus B Q1 upon 2 as it is upon 2B. So if we take this 2B from right hand side to left hand side, it moves from denominator to numerator. So now we have 2B Q1 is equal to A by 2 plus B Q1 upon 2. So therefore, if you take these two from right hand side to left hand side, it moves from denominator to numerator again. So now we have 4B Q1 is equal to A plus B Q1. So therefore, the value of Q1 is A upon 3B. If we do this simple mathematics, we can derive this equation here. So Q1 is equal to A upon 3B. This is the profit maximizing output or profit maximizing quantity of firm 1. Now we can substitute this quantity or this value into Q2. Now we are substituting this into Q2 to find the profit maximizing quantity of firm 2. So this is Q2. Now we are substituting the value of Q1 into Q2. So in this equation Q2, we have A minus B into Q1. So instead of Q1, we are writing this, that is A upon 3B upon 2B. So Q2 is equal to A minus A upon 3 upon 2B. Therefore, Q2 is equal to 3A minus A upon 6B. So Q2 is equal to 2A upon 6B. Therefore, Q2 is also equal to A upon 3B. So this is the profit maximizing output. Profit maximizing output of firm 2. So now if you observe the values of Q1 and Q2, both are same. So in Cournot model, Q1 is equal to Q2, right? So output is equally divided between two firms. So Q is equal to Q1 plus Q2. So now we can find the total quantity. So Q is equal to A plus 3B plus A plus 3B, A upon 3B. So it is 2A upon 3B. This is the total quantity of the Cournot model. The total quantity or total output produced by both the firms in the market. So now this Q is equal to 2A upon 3B in case of Cournot model. Now let's find the price. So price is equal to A minus BQ. Now instead of Q, we can write 2A upon 3B. So A minus B into 2A upon 3B, which is equal to A minus 2A upon 3. We can cancel this B out. So 3A minus 2A upon 3. So price is equal to A by 3. So this is the equilibrium price. And this is equilibrium quantity in case of Cournot model. Now let's understand this Steckelberg model. Again, firms quantity, competing quantity. So here we have this similarity in Cournot model as well as in Steckelberg model. Both the firms are competing in quantity. So quantity is the strategic variable. Here firms recognize their interdependence. In case of Cournot model, firms do not recognize their interdependence. In this case, both the firms recognize their interdependence and therefore they do not take the decision simultaneously. In this case, one firm decides or one firm first takes the decision and another firm follows the decision of the first firm or the leader to decide its own output. And therefore, it is known as sequential move game or sequential game. Again, both the firms are selling the homogeneous product. So suppose we have two firms, firm one and firm two. Firm one moves first. We assume that firm one moves first and take the decision. And second firm follows the decision of firm one and then takes the decision. So here firm one is known as strategic leader or aggressive player because that firm moves first in the market. And second firm follows the decision of first firm and therefore it is known as strategic follower or Steckelberg follower or passive player. So again, we assume that first firm moves first and second firm follows the decision of firm one. Now, when we have a Steckelberg model or when we have the sequential game, it is very important whether is there any advantage to be a leader. If there is no advantage to move first in the market, then there is no reason to be a leader. So when we find the equilibrium output, we compare the Cournot and Steckelberg model to find whether this firm is making any difference in the market or not, or whether this firm is earning more profit or not. So what is the demand curve? A is equal to B minus Q. Again, Q is divided between two firms. So Q is equal to Q1 plus Q2. So all these equations are same as we have seen in the Cournot model. This is our demand curve, final demand curve. And for simplicity, we assume that marginal cost is equal to zero. Now, in a sequential move game, we first solve the problem in the second period. And then we move backward to first period. So in Stackelberg model, we know that in second period, firm 2 takes the decision. Because in the first period, first firm, that is firm 1, moves first and take the decision. And in the second period, firm 2 decides its own output by considering the output of firm 1. So in sequential move game, or it is a method to solve the sequential move game, that we first solve the problem in the second period and then we move backward to first period. So in second period, firm 2 takes the decision. So we first find the equilibrium of firm 2. So TR2 is equal to PQ2. So if we substitute the value of P, we will find this outcome. This is exactly equal to the Cournot outcome of firm 2. You can see here Q2 is equal to A minus BQ1 upon 2B, which is the reaction curve of firm 2. This is the same result, right? Now, first firm takes into account the reaction function of firm 2. So here we have this reaction function. This is reaction function of firm 2. And this firm, that is the leader firm, takes into account the function of the follower firm or firm 2. So TR1 is equal to PQ1. So instead of P, we can write A minus BQ1 minus BQ2 into Q1. So this is the output of TR1, or the total revenue of firm 1. Now we substitute the value of this Q2 in this equation. So what is the value of Q2? It is A minus BQ1 upon 2B. So instead of Q2, we write this value. So now our total revenue curve of firm 1 is AQ1 minus BQ1 square minus BQ1 into, now instead of Q2, we have written the value of Q2, that is A minus BQ1 upon 2B. So this is the total revenue of firm 1. Now, if we open up the bracket, we will get this equation, that is AQ1 as it is, minus BQ1 square also as it is, minus, now we have BQ1 into A upon 2B, minus into minus becomes positive, so we have plus sign, B square, Q1 square upon 2B. So this is our total revenue. So AQ1 minus BQ1 square, so here this BB cancel, here also 1B is cancelled. So we have this equation AQ1 minus BQ1 square minus AQ1 upon 2 plus BQ1 square upon 2. So now AQ1 minus AQ1 upon 2 is AQ1 upon 2. Similarly, BQ1 square upon 2 minus BQ1 square is also BQ1 square upon 2. So this is our total revenue. 1 upon 2 is common. So now we have AQ1 minus BQ1 square. We know that marginal revenue is the differentiation of total revenue with respect to quantity. So here we differentiate total revenue of first firm with respect to Q1. So this is TR1. If we differentiate AQ1, we will get A. And if we differentiate BQ1 square with respect to Q1, we get 2BQ1. And if we now open the bracket, it is 1 by 2A minus BQ1. So this is the marginal revenue of firm 1. Now in equilibrium, we know that MR1 is equal to MC is equal to 0. This is MR1, 1 by 2A minus BQ1 is equal to 0. So 1 by 2A is equal to BQ1. So Q1 is equal to 2B. So this is the profit maximizing quantity of firm 1, that is A upon 2B. Right? Now we substitute this value into Q2. So what is the reaction function of firm 2? Q2 is A minus BQ1 upon 2B. So instead of Q1, we can write A upon 2B. So Q2 is equal to A minus A upon 2 upon 2B. This BB cancels out. So now we have A minus A upon 2 upon 2B. So Q2 is A upon 4B. This is the profit maximizing output of firm 2. So the output of leader, that is firm 1, is A upon 2B, and output of follower is A upon 4B. Now you can see here the output of both the firms are different. In case of Cournot model, both the firms produce the same output, or the total output is divided equally. But here, total output is not divided equally. Right? Now, Q is equal to Q1 plus Q2. So, Q is A upon 2B plus A upon 4B. So, if you solve the equation, we will get this answer. Q is equal to 3A upon 4B. This is the total output of the Stackelberg model. That is output of both the firms. Now, if we substitute this value into the demand equation, we will get the value of P. So P is equal to A minus B. Instead of Q, we can write this 3A upon 4B. So P is equal to A minus 3A upon 4. B, we cancel. So P is equal to 4A minus 3A upon 4. So P is equal to A upon 4. So this shows the equilibrium quantity. This shows the equilibrium price. Now we compare the Cournot and Stackelberg model. First, both the firms compete in quantity. So this is a similarity. Second, Cournot is a simultaneous move game, whereas Stackelberg is a sequential move game. So here in Cournot model, both the firms take decisions simultaneously. In Stackelberg model, one firm moves first and second firm follows the decision of first firm and then decide its own profit maximizing quantity. Now if you see, QC is the Cournot output. It is 2A upon 3B. And QS is the Stackelberg output, that is 3A upon 4B. So Stackelberg output is higher than the Cournot output, or Cournot output is less than Stackelberg output. So Stackelberg model, or the output or total quantity in Stackelberg model, is higher than the Cournot model. In other words, Cournot output is lower than the Stackelberg output. On the other hand, if you observe the price, the Cournot price is A upon 3 and Stackelberg price is A upon 4. So Cournot price is higher than the Stackelberg price. So this is the idea of duopoly market and two very important duopoly models, that is Cournot model and Stackelberg model. So we have discussed the how two firms achieve equilibrium in the Cournot and Stackelberg model and their comparison. So thank you very much for joining this session. If you find this video useful, kindly forward to your friends, and do not forget to subscribe my channel Crack Economics and Statistics, and you can also share the this video with your friends. You can also see the posts or videos on this channel on economics, statistics and SPSS. So I'm signing off right now, and if you have any doubts, you can write in the comment. If you have any doubts of the previous sessions, you can also note down, or you can also ask the questions in the comment. We will try to answer your questions if they are related to the sessions, if they are related to the content of the video. So thank you very much, and in the next session we are going to discuss the other theories of microeconomics. Thank you, everyone.